week of our Slaying the Giants series. It's hard to believe we've already been at this for 4 weeks. Today we have Patrice Farrell DeLine with us, and Patrice serves as our regional VP of mission integration for Lutheran, Platte Valley, and Good Samaritan. And today Patrice will be talking about slaying the giant of anger. So I will turn it over to Patrice.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thanks so much for this opportunity, Caitlin. And I look forward to spending this time with everyone. So I guess to begin with, why don't we all just take 1 second and take a nice big deep breath. If you're like me, you've been probably tackling 5 other things this morning. So perhaps just a deep breath before we begin. So I'm the daughter of a full-blooded 100% Irishman. My father seemed to have only 2 switches on his emotional dial: love and anger. He was either full of love or full of anger, but rarely anything else in between. My mother named his outbursts as having an Irish temper. My 6 siblings and I named it Dad's major meltdowns, as we tried to stay out of his way and hope to be invisible. When Caitlin asked me to speak on the expression of non-sinful anger, I had to pray on that for a bit, and a bit, and a bit. My struggle growing up with a dad whose fits of anger scared the daylights out of me, prevented me from seeing anger as anything but destructive, scary, and selfish. It was never on my radar that my father's anger could also be considered sinless in certain situations. Paul says something in verse 26 that has always confused me: be angry and do not sin. This seems tricky. Is it really possible to be angry without sinning? There are certain examples of Jesus expressing anger. John described Jesus' anger when he drove the merchants and money changers out of the temple in Jerusalem. To understand why Jesus did what he did, we have to understand the context of what was happening in the temple at that time. The money changers and the merchants were extortionists, cheating poor travelers out of their money. When Israelites came to the temple to offer a sacrifice, the animals that they brought would be disapproved by the temple officials. They were then forced to purchase approved animals at an inflated price from the corrupt merchants and money changers. Jesus's anger was first directed at the injustice toward temple worshipers. Secondly, Jesus was angry because the worship of God was being obstructed by the booths and the tables and the chaos that was set up in the court of the Gentiles. This area of the temple was supposed to be for the Gentiles who wanted to worship the true God. They couldn't even get near that because the court had been turned into a mall of animal sellers and money changers and other chaos. So how was Jesus's anger without sin? His anger was not about his own stuff, his own agenda, his own rights, his own hang-ups, or a demonstration of selfishness. Instead, his anger was over injustice, greed, and the obstruction of religious beliefs. Jesus teaches us that there is room for anger in our hearts if it is directed at the abuse of righteousness and justice and love and compassion. It is not used as a tool of retribution or intimidation when we don't get our own way, or a mechanism to vent our own frustrations. Although my dad was not a great role model when it came to controlling sinful anger, he was someone who demonstrated passion, enthusiasm, love, and commitment. He loved to cheer on the underdog in any situation. He saw the human dignity in every individual, and he would help a stranger whenever he could, even when we didn't have any money to spare. When he observed injustice in any form, he never hesitated to raise his voice with passion and sometimes with anger in an attempt to change the situation or come to someone else's rescue. This last year has been filled with examples of sinful and sinless anger. How do we check ourselves in the midst of racial injustice, political discourse, inequity, and hate? When Paul says not to let the sun go down on our anger, he is saying, don't nurse your anger. Don't protect it and coddle it or give it a place to live long term. I would ask you to share, how do we do this, especially right now? How do we express sinless anger when we see a situation that goes against the will and commands of God? Can any of you offer some examples? Any thoughts on that?
I'm sorry, Patrice, I was on mute. This is Deb. Thanks for sharing those thoughts on anger. I think that's such a huge issue right now, especially for all of us in this culture. But I'm struck by your last words of not coddling or nurturing anger. And when you ask about, you know, how do you control that, I think there's, you know, offering a pause. I think so often I run with anger or I jump in. And if I take a step back or pause for a moment, I think there's almost that ability to control it better if I just take a moment.
Thanks, Deb. Yeah, I really relate to that. I think, you know, it's not the case of pretending like we don't get angry, right? Or that there aren't things to be angry about. But I think so much of it is, what do we do with that anger? How do we channel that in ways to make change, but not be destructive to other people or to other situations, but also to ourselves, right? And I think that's key. And I think relating that back to my dad is that I do think it did eat at him. I know he being angry and having those tantrums were not something he enjoyed, right? Or felt good about. So I know it ate at him. And I think, I would think in most people, it does the same. So it's how do you find that healthy anger, right? And balance that. But thanks, Deb.
It's interesting, Patrice. I've been working with a person who is in his dying stages and he's got a lot of anger. And that can be where he wants to dwell. And so he's not having an easy time of dying. And so one of the things that he and I talked about is I told him I was coming for 2 days. One day he could talk about his anger and then we'd let go of it. And then the next day he had to talk about what he loved about life. And it's been interesting because his family has all come together now and they said, you know, Dad likes it when you show up. And I said, well, I give him some boundaries. And I said, you guys have to do the same. Because if you sit and listen to him be angry, then you're going to leave angry because you didn't get quality time. And so I said, we have to claim our own stuff for ourselves, because the last memory you have of your dad, you don't want it to be him yelling about which one of the kids let the horse out of the barn. And they kind of laughed and said, yeah. So I think, you know, I think I learned from them, but I hope that this journey might be a time of grace, because I don't think he likes being angry. He said that one the day we talked, and but he doesn't know how not to be right now.
Mm. I think that's a great point, Dorothy, I think there is a lot of how do we not, I love that. Thank you. And I think that's a wonderful suggestion too, of it's not that we, it's not important that people express anger, right? But how do we express it without dwelling and in it? Thank you, Dorothy.
You know, I think when we feel angry or encounter anger, I think the question I ask or I suggest myself is, Leanna, go deeper. You know, so it's always invitation to go deeper, because it's either, you know, touches on your own wound or something has touched on a person's wound. And that's why, you know, they are angry. So it's really about centering oneself in empathy and going deeper and deeper. People are layers of cake. You know, we all have these layers. And I think if you sit in that place of really trying to understand deeper, you know, it gives you a different perspective. And many times I would pray and say, now, God, reveal me what I don't know yet. Because many times the anger is because I don't know yet something about the situation or the person, you know. So that's kind of what I try to remind myself, go deeper.
And to tag on, sorry, this is Cheryl in Billings. To tag along what Lena was saying, sometimes we as humans will express anger when indeed there's something even more deep, like fear or anxiety going on.
Right.
And so sometimes it will express itself as an anger, partly because we, as perhaps the person who is angry, doesn't quite get what's happening deeper into our soul. And then the ones that we're with, if they're the ones being angry, same thing. It's a fear. It's an anxiety. It's a misunderstanding of even what's happening deeper. So sometimes understanding that aspect, and I think, again, it's just mirroring what Lena was saying. It's coming to the understanding of what's deeper and going on so, so deep into the soul. Mm-hmm.
And what's interesting is that we tend to be able to give that grace to children, right? When a child is angry and having a temper tantrum, if we're on our game, right, as a parent, most of the time we will think, okay, so what's really going on here, right? This isn't just about not getting that sucker. Are they not feeling well? Are they, you know, is their clothes uncomfortable? I mean, what is it, right? That's I one of my kiddos used to get horrible ear infections, and she was born in the era of avoid tubes at all cost. And kind of the pendulum had swung before her. I think they were throwing tubes into kids' ears right and left. And she happened to come along in a period where they were just avoiding them like crazy. And so, and she got so many ear infections. And finally, we got to the point that we could pick up her ear infection within like 2 hours of her getting it, right? Because her attitude and everything changed so quickly. But it took us a while to get there. And the poor little thing, I know, suffered and would have tantrums and get so angry. Well, it's because she wasn't feeling good, but we didn't know that. And so I think it so relates to what you're saying, is that why don't we do that more as adults, right? Why don't we dig deeper? Why don't we find out why that person, you know, what's causing them to live in that anger, and how can we help? So I love that. Thank you.
You know, Patrice, it's Deb. I wonder about even asking those questions of ourselves when we find that anger bubbling up within us. Why are we angry? What is it that bothers me? I know we've got several of our chaplains on this phone call, but that's part of, you know, their training is to ask those questions about what's happening within me. And I think as you were talking about, or I think Cheryl was talking about, you know, asking those questions of others, but do we even stop and ask that of ourselves?
Absolutely.
I think question, you know, sometimes I love to ask, in situations working with patients, angry patients, is what's hurting? Mm-hmm. You know, just turning it on and say, what's really hurting here? You know, and I think that's a question to ask oneself too. You know, what's really is hurting?
That's great, Leanna. You should do this for a living.
Yeah, exactly.
and sometimes that hurt isn't always physiological. And that's what we're referring to. Mm-hmm. And it makes me think of one time I came home and must have been a little bit aggressive. And my husband said, boy, are you just mad? And I said, I had to pause. And I said, well, no, you know what? I think I'm just actually really sad. And then we were able to go on with that discussion. But until he actually pointed it out, and he wasn't being naughty about it, he just boy, are you mad? And then it took that bit of reflection for myself even. So what a great point. We do have to look inward and see. And so turned out I was actually sad. I was sad and had to work on that. So it was a good question.
Very good.
And I do think this is Miffy in at St. Mary's in Grand Junction, and this has been great listening to everybody with their interpretations of, you know, what makes people angry and, you know, why it bubbles to the surface, and that was a beautiful presentation that you gave on your father. I can relate in different ways. Being married to a husband who had a high level of anger inside of him. And then he would burst out with, you know, some violent episodes that weren't too abusive, but they were on the borderline. And I could see in his eyes sometimes when he was so angry, you know, I could tell there was like almost like adrenaline or something running through him that would trigger a change in his system. Just what what everybody's brought into this conversation about, like the children, like it really touched me about talking about how we have that liberty with our children and grandchildren for me, because I have a grandchild who, you know, has bursts of anger and that's one of the first things his mom does is, you know, she'll say, you know, what is it that's, you know, bothering you? You know, tell me, you know, and she talks him through it as opposed to, you know, reacting like we often do with as adults. Mm-hmm. And it also, you know, just this opportunity for us to be able to reflect on our own anger, the COVID circumstance and being alone or being in a confined space with someone that you love and, you know, have to live with, you know, not by choice, can lead to those sad or angry feelings that you have to talk yourself out of sometimes. So much more now than we have had to do, at least for myself. I know, you know, because I'm a happy person in general. That's what everybody tells me. I'm, you know, very upbeat and have a positive attitude. There have been some times during this whole COVID thing where, you know, I've been reflective and have found myself going from sad to angry. So this has been great.
Oh, good. Thank you, Miffy. When I'm listening to you all as well, and even thinking about the children, some of you may know, I worked at Mount St. Vincent Home for 6 years. And that is one of our sites for SEL, and it is a residential and day treatment facility for children that have experienced abuse and neglect and mental illness. And never have I seen kids that before working there that had experienced what they experienced and how it would come out for them. And I used to call some of the staff children whisperers, because they were so talented in being able to take a child that is so angry and help them to figure out what was causing that anger and how else can we process that and express themselves in a different way. And it's funny because I haven't thought of that for a while. And when I was looking at this topic again, that when Caitlin gave it to me, I'm like, oh wow, really? Could I have the worry one or what are the other ones? there's five others. Can I have one of the other ones? It really hit me about the amazing work that's done there. And I've seen a couple people, Chris, I see you, your name up here. So I know Chris Dubuque is on the line and has been at MSV forever. I don't even want to quote how many years, Chris, but I'm sure it's over 20. But the work that's done there and that why as a society, why don't we put more effort into helping people to understand that anger can be treated, that we can help people to get help for their anger and things like that. And I thought of that with my dad who passed away several years ago from a stroke, maybe if we would have gotten him more help and maybe if we could have gotten him on medication and things like that, what difference would that have made? But I think it's part of the whole mental health again, that we constantly need to keep addressing, whether it's for children or for adults. How about the concept of the sinless anger versus anger? It's or anger that's with sin versus sinless anger. Have any of you thought of it in that context before? Quite honestly, I don't think I had really. I kind of looped all anger together. But does anybody have any thoughts on how that strikes you?
Yeah, I see it because you quoted Jesus getting angry at the temple, I guess.
Yes.
I don't think he committed any sin. He just saw how they treated the merchandise and extortion, kind of do extortion to get people's money and so forth. I look at it this way: it's okay to get angry if you see, let's say, like a parent's abusing their child in public. This because you see there's injustice there and you want to actually almost fight it. That doesn't mean because you show emotion of anger, that means something is wrong. No, you're passionate about something and you want to actually get the attention of others so they can come on board and help that defenseless or victim child or somebody else that's been mistreated for whatever it is based on a background and so forth.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you. Anyone else?
Yeah, I was just thinking just that distinction that you kind of referenced, Patrice, between the emotion and the action, right? So like emotions can rise up and in and of themselves, they're not bad or evil, but it's, you know, what we do with them or how we act upon them. I feel like anger is an emotion I'm like super uncomfortable with because I grew up, there's no like volatility, but my husband grew up with a lot more of that. And so he kind of brings that sometimes and I'll be like, oh my gosh, you shouldn't have been so angry or whatever. But he points out like, well, that was justified because of this or, you know, like. And so for me, it's almost like an exercise in becoming comfortable with, yeah, righteous anger, justified anger, but in making that distinction for the emotion versus the action, I think is helpful too.
Thank you. Well, I will close then with our time together with a prayer. I'm reminded through this discussion and thinking of this topic that God shows us the ultimate weapon to overcome anger. And that's the tender action of forgiving love. And perhaps that's another topic in another time, but I do think that's a big component of this. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, give us the strength to endure situations that challenge our patience, our convictions, and our belief in humankind. Help us to find the blessings and lessons that each situation brings. Give us the courage and endurance to continue ahead and guide our thoughts, our words, and actions so that we walk your path of peace, forgiveness, compassion, and love. Amen. I hope you all have a blessed day. Thank you so much for being on today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Patrice.
Thank you.